Greetings, everyone, and welcome to another edition of In Studio. I'm your host, Ted Perch. And this morning, we are spending some time with author Galaxy Craze, and we're going to be talking about her career as a writer and also her latest book called Map Maker, just out this past April. And it's a very good read, and it's a, what they call a young adult novel. It's in that demographic, and it's a very good read, and I want a sequel. But before we get into the particulars of the book and so forth, welcome to the program.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you.
Thanks.
Now, how did you get into becoming a writer? Where did that come from?
Well, I went to, I think I started writing in high school. Mm-hmm. And then I went to college to Barnard in New York. Mm. And there was this really great writing teacher named Mary Gordon. And she sort of mentored me. And I started writing short stories, and she showed a lot of encouragement. Mm-hmm. And then I applied for grad school to NYU, and I got awarded a full fellowship to go there.
Wow.
With a stipend, a teaching stipend. Oh, and then wow. I guess I got encouragement, and I started writing more and more. And I worked at Interview Magazine in the summer, and I'd worked at Details Magazine, so mm-hmm. I'd been doing a lot of other kinds of writing.
Right.
And then in grad school, I started my first book called By the Shore.
Yes, I read that. So that was your first book.
Yeah.
But writing seems to have been with you the whole time.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
Now, you mentioned Mary Gordon. Is
yeah.
that the novelist? Mary?
Yeah, the novelist,
oh,
Mary Gordon.
Oh, wow. What a teacher.
I know. She was great.
You got it right from the top.
Yeah.
Wow.
She was totally great.
Yeah, yeah. And so your first book was By the Shore.
Yeah, my first book was By the Shore.
And that's a story of, now tell me this, briefly the story.
Okay, so that's a grown-up. I've started writing young adult, which is age range like 12 to 17 or
right.
something. But that's, By the Shore was an adult novel, but mm-hmm. With the narrator was a 12-year-old girl
right.
who lives at a bed and breakfast in England with her mother and brother. And they usually have lonely, quiet winters, but this particular winter the book takes place, a guest comes.
Mm-hmm.
And the mother and the guest sort of have a romance.
Yes.
And the story unfolds from her point of view, which is of a 12-year-old. The story of a single mom who's separated from the father, who's not a bad guy, but he's not a very committed father.
Not hardly.
And she takes them, and she opens a bed and breakfast
right.
by in a small seaside town in England.
Mm-hmm.
And she has two children to take care of, but she's also a young mother.
Right.
She had her children when she was in her 18.
Yeah.
And so she's still discovering life, and she's sort of growing up with her children.
Yeah.
And then this writer comes to stay, who's sort of a mystery.
Yes.
And she unexpectedly falls in love with him.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And
he falls in love with her.
Yeah, and he falls in love with her, and the young girl who's telling the story is still holding onto a dream that her mother and father will get back together.
Yeah.
So when her father also comes to visit them, she's hoping the mother and father and their family will be reunited.
Right,
so
right.
there's a few conflicts.
And it doesn't happen.
Right.
Because she experiences that her father is a total jerk.
Right.
In a certain sort of way.
Right.
And he's more interested in himself and his rock and roll lifestyle.
Yeah.
That he keeps talking about. And he just disappears. And
yeah.
I think she, to me, it's like she finally figured out that whatever her illusion was, you know, she comes back to reality kind of. In writing a story like this with characters that are of a certain age, she's a 13-year-old and you're an adult, how do you get to do that? How do you write from that perspective? You get inside some, you know, 13, your own head, say, at 13, you sort of channel some of your own memories of when you were that age?
Yeah.
And how you would behave and think about situations like that?
Yeah, exactly. I just remember being that age and what life seemed like at that age and how the reactions one would have and how mm-hmm. almost dramatic everything seems sometimes and
yes.
how immediate.
I have two daughters, so I live through a lot of that kind of thing. It's particularly when May is interacting with her friends at school and the whole pecking order and the hierarchy and the mean girls and she's feeling left out and in and out and not really sure. It was so right on.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, yeah. The way this is written, and it's really important for girls to read, you know, to have this kind of material to read, to think about who this person is, because they can I think they can identify what a lot of what this person is living through, because they're living through the same things vicariously, kind of, maybe sometimes actually. I have two daughters, and I remember this kind of thing, and I'm a parent, and with both my girls when they were that age, it's a tough age. I mean, there's a lot going on that you don't even really know about as a parent, but there's a lot going on, and being a role model for kids reading this, who, you know, it helps. I think it helps to show them that they're not alone, that their experience is unique to them, but it's a kind of a condition of early adolescence and growing up, and the world opens up and it's very confusing, and the situation of your life can be very confusing, and May seems to go through it a day at a time. Some days are better than others, and she's trying to get things moving and trying to understand. And is that right?
Absolutely. Because when you're saying this, I'm thinking of those commercials that are for gay teens that say, it gets better. Yeah. Well, it gets better for lots of people, too. Like, you can have a bad childhood and then don't do anything drastic. Yeah, it's like, don't do anything drastic because it can get better. And it can get better. You can have a bad childhood. And you can change your life. So May is, like, struggling. And it feels also immediate, like the friends who are mean to her, the fact that her father doesn't particularly want to be her father. And it feels like she has no hope. But then as time goes on, like, hope emerges. Right. And things start to slowly get better.
Right.
I was going to write a sequel for May, she would go on. She'd go to college. She'd have friends. She'd get married. She'd have kids. Like, life would get better for May.
Right. So as time goes by,
yeah,
she meets these challenges,
yeah,
of her parentage and what's going on, and she, because of that, she threads her way through, finds her own place in that.
Right, and you can't let one bad girl or one mean girl bring you down. That can't be who's defining you.
That's right.
And May gets caught up in the mean girls, the popular girls, and then luckily she realizes they're mean girls, and she walks away from them.
Yeah, I think we all go through that, you know.
Yeah.
At some periods of our life when we allow others to identify us, and eventually, hopefully, you figure out that that's really not the right way to go. You have to define yourself, and that's not easy.
No.
But depending on your situation, like you say, it takes time.
Right.
And as you grow, your perspective changes on things, and so at the end of By the Shore, it seems as though most of this has been resolved.
Yeah.
The man and her mother seem to have made this connection that they were both very hesitant about.
Right.
I think the last part of it is that they're on the beach and they're walking on the beach, and she's observing this, and she seems to feel the mood seems to be that there's been some resolution.
Yeah, it's a happy ending.
Yeah, it's a happy ending.
Yes, for everyone. They've all come to some resolution.
Yeah, yeah. Your books are what they call young adult novels, and
I started writing young adult books about 3 years ago.
So how did that come about? What's the draw?
Well, what happened was a publisher who'd read By the Shore and liked the voice of the young girl had been for years asking me to write YA.
Oh.
And then finally they came to me with an idea, this company called Alloy, that does really popular YA books like Pretty Little Liars, Gossip Girl, The Vampire Diaries, and they came with an idea, and they asked me to write it. So I started writing a book for them called The Last Princess, and then I wrote a sequel to that called Invasion. And these were more formulaic, like the company asked me to do it, and I did the writing. But it was fun because it was collaborative, and it was very strict deadlines, and I had two young children, so I needed that kind of work. And then after The Last Princess, I started... Another publisher asked me to collaborate with a screenwriter, Mark Bombeck, on Mapmaker. Mm-hmm. And that was also really fun because writing can be very lonely and isolating.
Yeah.
And it was collaborative, and it was fun, and it was YA, and it's always fun to be in the voice of a teenager.
Yeah, that's right. It's the voice of a teenager.
Yeah.
And I'm a retired librarian, so YA literature is hugely popular, and I think for the right reasons. You know, kids need to identify, and it's time tested. Kids need to identify with heroines and heroes and other kids their age who are going through not difficulties, but are challenged by by life and the situations they find them in. And it always seems as through storytelling and through literature that has characters in it that are their age, that I think is very, very, it's not therapeutic perhaps, maybe that's too big a word, but I think it's helpful because kids can, once again, they can say, well, this character is going through some of what I am, they identify with that, and I think it's very helpful so they can take on some of that, some of the solutions.
Yeah.
Well, I'll try some version of how this person dealt with monsters or some there's always monsters or some sort of huge challenge that they have to overcome. But that's true of most, I think that's true of most storytelling and most fiction, even for adults.
Yeah.
So we're talking about young adult literature and what it's all about. So what is it about young adult literature that you find so interesting, or how you got into it? And as an artist, what's the...
I think writing from the perspective of a young adult is very interesting because you haven't, by the time you're 12 or 14 or 16 even, had time to become immune to all life's hurts.
No.
By the time you're like 35, you're just can brush things off. You know, you'll have good days, you'll have bad days. But it's so immediate to children. Children are so present. And the first time your friend betrays you could be the worst thing in the world as a 16-year-old. Or the first time a boy is mean to you, or you know,
you
see your father ignore you. Like something very, it can be very immediate and painful. And accessing those feelings is very immediate, direct, and children are really present. Mm-hmm. And it just is a very interesting way to write because it's very clear-cut, straightforward. Mm-hmm. And I'm a straightforward, clear-cut person. When I'm reading books, like, I don't necessarily want like 5 pages of description.
Right.
I want 2 lines of accurate description.
Yeah.
I don't, and I do like action, and I do like plot, and I like strong characters.
You have 2 children of your own.
Yeah, 2 children. Yeah.
I'm thinking here that in order to kind of, for me, in order to become fluid with that kind of perspective, I would have to spend a lot of time around teenagers or so, just to get familiar with how they think and how they behave, and watch them go through that stuff.
Yeah.
I have memories of my own children going through that. So, but I would have, it would have to be something I'd have to really, really recall.
Right.
And talk to them about.
Uh huh.
Because it's for me, it's long enough ago. But so there is, there's got to be a certain sort of talent that you have for
that kind of
observation.
Yeah, I do like to observe, and I will go somewhere and sit and just observe.
Yeah,
and I do think I do have a very good memory, and I kept journals from that time.
My time
as a teenager is different, only in mostly the way of social media and phones.
Right.
So in the book, like, a lot of stuff happens via text that wouldn't have happened, say, 15 years ago.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's the only real difference. But I think the teenage emotion, like, even if you read Judy Blume, it's still the same teenage emotion, but in a different setting with different clothes and different technology.
Right. So actually, you have a whole history of other authors who have set the stage, kind of, so you can go right in there. And.
But I also don't write down, that's what I was thinking, like, I have never once been like, whoa, what would it feel like to be much younger?
Yeah.
I don't write down to the teenager.
No.
I just write as though I'm writing to adults,
right.
But the girl happens to be 16. I don't talk down to the teenagers or the young adults.
They would spot that right away.
It just never occurs to me to do
Good.
That. So I think I just write the way, this book would have been written the same if it was for 90-year-olds. Like, it's the same voice. It just has to be a true voice.
True voice, right.
That's
right.
What it has to be. You can't put affected words in. I don't put affected words. I usually have plain words.
Right. No, it's, and you're right. And it's captivating because it's real. What, you know, the dialogue and the characters and the settings, they really are real. And you also have a talent for writing particular lines that just, in one of the, actually in this book and the other book, these particular observations that just stick there. One, I think, for me, May said something about at the end of the book that if you just give yourself up to the care of the world, it'll take care of you. Specific words I forget.
Yeah.
And I'm looking at, I wrote it down because it was so spiritual and real. If you trust the universe, the universe will take care of you. It's like, wow. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's something. That's a great thought.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks. Yeah. May had more thoughts like that because she was a.
Yeah.
She was 12-year-old. You're even more open. By the time you're 14, 15, 16, you're even a little more cynical.
Right.
So it wouldn't have been appropriate for, say, Tanya in this book to have that thought. But May, you kind of just sort of like commune with the character and write. You just sort of become. And I used to act.
Ah.
So I think that really helps.
That helps. Yeah. 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 Because you can be the character.
Yeah. You just be the character.
Yeah. I keep repeating this on some shows that a friend of mine is a novelist, and he has told me once that when he writes and his characters call him, everything else goes away, and he becomes that person. He becomes, he's inhabiting that particular space with those characters.
Yeah.
And I think that's what you have to do, probably, just to sort of be there. And we're gonna get to your latest book in a second, but. Tanya also has this observation when she's out, and she says something about, well, I think I'm going to remember this sprained ankle as being in some part of my life. She's going to always look back on this incident, and she's going to remember where she was and what she was doing and the whole thing. I think, that happens to all of us, but it's kind of like for a kid, but a teenager.
Yeah.
I mean, that's such a wonderful observation.
Thank you.
Yeah, no, it's... So, we've come to your latest work. It's called Map Maker. I don't know if you can see that very well, but we'll have an image posted. And it's just come out in April, about a month ago. And it's your latest work, and it's set here in the local area. So, tell me about that.
So, it's set in Amherst, Massachusetts, and Tanya works for an internet company called MapOut. And the owner of the company cynically says he has his offices in Amherst because he gets brilliant brains at sweatshop prices from all the local grad students,
UMass and so forth.
So he has a big warehouse, which is along the bike path in Amherst, and that's where Tanya starts her internship for the summer.
Yeah.
And in many of the settings, like she'll meet her friends for coffee at Rayo's and
mentioned Amherst Cinema.
And Amherst Cinema. It's really fun. It was fun to write locally where I live and use those settings.
It's great. It's also great to read because you can
really picture it.
Really picture it. Oh, it's a real place.
Yeah.
Amherst Cinema. I've been there.
Yeah.
And now the company that she's interning with, there's a backstory.
Mm-hmm.
Like there should be. A backstory. Her father is missing, presumed dead.
Yeah.
Oh, I should.
No, that's fine. So her
and her father actually started this company with another partner, and her mother has passed away. And she's living with her stepmother, and it's a dicey kind of relationship, and she's 17, 18.
Yeah.
So she's in this place personally as well of transition and things going on. So tell me. So continue the story.
She is working at the company her father founded with his business partner. Mm-hmm. In the past year, her father has disappeared on a mapping expedition and is presumed dead. The body was never found.
Right.
So she starts her internship, and she meets her childhood friend, who's the son of the other owner.
Right.
His name's Connor. And they realize that something is wrong at the company.
Right.
And one night they break in to get to Tanya's father's computer, and they start to investigate Tanya's father's. Mm-hmm. Tanya's father had triple passcode on his computer.
Yeah,
so she uses her knowledge of computers and of her father, what he would have used for passcode. And she breaks into the computer and finds some very mysterious emails he's written to a friend. And they start to investigate.
And then all hell breaks loose.
Yeah. Yeah.
It becomes this kidnapping story and people chasing her. It's this whole action thing, and she meets her father's friend in Alaska.
Yeah.
And she's off the grid. These people are trying to kill her.
Yeah.
This is not your, this is serious business here.
Right. So she goes with Connor, and her mission is to try and figure out actually what happened to her dad, right. And that takes her into all sort of uncharted, scary territory.
Yeah, really uncharted. Yeah. Underground complexes and it's
all about technology and how people are tracked through their iPhones, and she has to rid herself of this.
Yeah.
So then she goes completely off the grid.
Yes, and that's a very relevant, timely subject of, you know, we have GPSs in our...
I know.
And they're talking about, you know, I think there's a... And if you have a Apple Watch, the same thing. We don't have chips in us, yes, but I think that stuff is out there.
Yeah.
So...
Well, if you have your iPhone on you...
Yeah.
Someone can track it by Find My iPhone, can track all your movements.
Right.
If you were to have somebody else, whatever. But, yeah, I mean... So
and you see that all the time on crime shows. Well, we can track them by a cell phone, as if at this point nobody knows.
Right.
Everybody knows that there's GPS on your phone.
Yeah.
But sometimes we don't think, oh, GPS. Well, oh, they could find me.
Criminals aren't that smart. Right. They do.
So she goes. The all hell breaks loose, and she finds her. I'm not giving away the book because there's much more to this in detail. But she actually finds her father.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of the end of the story. She has to escape from this place because
the
bad guys are still after her.
And so Tanya also has a gift of direction,
which is why
she's working for a map out company. She just has an innate sense of spatial and direction. She has a spatial gift.
Yeah.
And that's why part of the reason they hired her to do their mapping.
Right, because you can spin her around in circles and know exactly which direction she's and how far away. She's got this thing. Well, I'm actually 35 yards from this, maybe 40.
Yeah.
Yeah. So she's a great heroine. So far, I want a sequel to this book because I felt hung up at the end.
It's I know.
I turned the page and there was no. I said, oh no.
I know. I want a sequel too. I have to get the permission from the publisher.
You have a collaborator on this
on
this book, a man named Mark Bombeck. So, tell me about him and why he or how. You know, he was brought into this, and how it's structured the whole thing.
Mark Bombeck is a screenwriter, and it was his concept.
Ah.
And he writes huge Hollywood movies, mm-hmm. like Planet of the Apes, Wolverine, Live Free or Die.
Uh-huh.
And so he's like really about concept and plot. And I'm usually write quieter books that are more character driven and more setting orientated mm-hmm. and more atmospheric.
So there's this collaboration between his perspective and yours.
Yeah, so that was really fun. So I did the writing.
Yeah.
But he and I worked on the plotting, and he would come up with very interesting like twists and turns that I wouldn't necessarily have come up with, and like the kidnapping thing. Like that's a very big plot thing that I might have not come up with because I'm more of a complete realist.
But Mark is a screenwriter,
which
means he's writing from a different perspective. He structures his screenwriters structure their work differently than even if they're working from a book, they change the whole way it moves.
Right.
So, what did he bring into your work, or how did you? What's the collaboration?
The collaboration is his concept,
right?
And it's a very big concept. I would never have come up with such a big concept. My books are usually quieter and more atmospheric and more character-driven mm-hmm. and more subtle.
Right.
So Mark came up with all these amazing like twists and turns and all this very big type plot that I would never have probably come up with on my own.
Right. There's a lot of action involved.
Yeah, a lot of action. And so it was really it wouldn't have seemed like it would be the perfect pair, but it was turned out to be a really great combination.
It's a great book.
Oh, thank you.
I enjoyed reading it because there is action in it and it moves. And you get on at the beginning and you're taken along on this ride.
Right.
And you're experiencing all this with her, and it's a very visual. You can see yourself being kidnapped and getting out of the car in Virginia, not knowing where you are and the whole thing. So I have a feeling that this is going to end up being a film at some point.
That would be nice.
Yeah. So long as you have the film rights or whatever you get from it, you know, don't give your story away, and the reason I say that is because it's filmmaking. This kind of film is popular now.
Yeah.
You know, not teenage protagonists, but young adult protagonists. It's an extension of the book.
Right.
You have young people who are faced with a challenge, and you know, and you experience them going through it.
And it's a female protagonist, like she's calling the shots.
Yeah.
It would be great. It's a powerful young woman.
Once again, it's a very powerful message to young women that you can, you have it all. You have what you need. We all get tested mm-hmm. in life. And, you know, her inner strength and so forth comes out, and some of her dilemmas and of that age or whatever get worked out. And I've said over and over that I've really enjoyed reading this. And,
thank you.
And it's a great book for kids to read and for young women to read and to get a hold of and get into. And this is the book Mapmaker. So with your career as a writer, mm-hmm. as a young adult writer, it doesn't matter, as a writer, what would be your advice to young people, or people of any age, really, who want to express themselves this way and learn how to do this?
To write,
yeah.
To write novels?
Yeah, or in general. You've written for magazines and everything else, and you know, how does one...
Well, I got some really good advice when I was in grad school. When I was in college.
Yeah.
So Mary Gordon, again, who was a very big mentor to me. And what people need is encouragement.
Yeah.
So one thing you can do is when you're sitting in these creative writing classes and everyone's reading your work and everyone's going to have a take.
Yeah.
But you don't take all the advice. You just take the advice that rings true to you.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to have a heart. You brush off the bad advice. I mean, I've gotten to points where I've thrown out manuscripts because someone said, oh, I didn't really like that part. And I was just like, oh, I can't rewrite it.
Right,
I'm just going to throw the whole thing out. But now I look back and I think, I was so stupid. Like, most mm-hmm. people would have just reworked it. So you need encouragement and you need faith in yourself. And then some practical advice that I got from Mary Gordon is when I was in Barnard and I was going to apply to writing school,
mm-hmm.
she said, only go to writing school if you're getting a great amount of financial aid. Or you're going for free. Like I had a teaching stipend.
Mm-hmm.
Because the difference is when you graduate from writing school, you are not guaranteed a job like a lawyer would be or a doctor.
No.
You do not want to go into debt.
No.
Because then you probably won't be able to write because you're doing another job paying debt.
Paying your student loans.
Yeah, saying you're done to be a writer, so you have no time to write. So my advice would be, you know, you just write, you get people's opinions, take what you want,
mm-hmm.
don't let people get you down. You have to have faith in yourself.
Yeah, right.
And learn, I think a good thing to know is the basics, like beginning, middle, end, right. Learn a narrative.
It's a discipline, right?
Yeah.
You know, you're focusing on the use of language in a focused way.
Yeah.
And it's a discipline. And it's something that you have to learn how to do.
Which is the hardest part. I don't if I have something else pressing,
right.
Writing does take a backseat, like now that I have children. And that's why writing the YA books were so good, because they had a timeline and a deadline,
right.
And you had to meet it.
But you've learned the discipline, so you can just
drop back into it. Hardest part.
Yeah.
I just think have faith in yourself, and if there's something that interests you, follow it through.
Right.
Don't listen to the naysayers.
Right. Do it.
Don't go into debt for being a writer.
Right. But do it.
Yeah, just do it. Yeah.
And the rest will, you know, the rest is part of what you learn and your experience.
Yeah. And if you like it, follow it.
Yeah. Absolutely. Galaxy, it's been great having you here and talking about your work. And I'm hoping, keep writing. I don't have to tell you that, but, you know, keep writing, and I'm hoping for a sequel for this, because I'm hooked, and I want to know what happens.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming. It's good to see you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
All right. So, here's the book. The latest book has just come out in April from Galaxy Craze. It's Mapmaker, and it's available, I'm sure it's available in local bookstores and so forth, but you can also, there's a website here. It's printed by Soho Press, and we'll put the website on our credits. It's sohoteen.com. So, from all of us to all of you, I'm still Ted Perch, and I'm still the host of this program. And we've spent some time with author Galaxy Craze, and it's been great. So, we'll see you next time. We'll be right back.
my parting words would be relax, have fun, and rest easy.
And aloha.
Aloha. Aloha. Okay. Thank you.